join us in singing that great song about our country. Stand with me, please. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain. Do we live in a beautiful country? Absolutely we do. And I hope you love it, and I hope we're honorable today as we celebrate our country and our God. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains, majesties, all of our fruits and grain. America, America, God send His grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Let's sing that last verse together. Oh, would you remain standing, please, for the presentation of the colors?
Attention, salute. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Join me in singing the national anthem. We'll salute the same flag. Posting of the colors.
Detail. Thank you. You may be seated. We love America here at Franklin Root Baptist Church. How many give you a good hearty amen? You love America? And we're going to have the red, white, and blue flying today. We're so thankful to have guests with us today, and a good number of our military are here today, those that are currently serving, those who have served in the past, those retired. And just a while, we'll get a chance to recognize all of you. And then, of course, we have many of our dignitaries, local and state. We're so thankful to have them with us as well. And at the conclusion of the service, you'll get to meet all of them. So stick right with us. And then we're honored to have Medal of Honor recipient, Vietnam War era, Gary Beikirch, and his wife with us today. And we're anxious to hear from him again this year. We are glad you're here. God's given us a beautiful day today. And let me just say this, that if you're a guest today, if this is the first time you've been with us or first time in a long time, we'd love you to look in the seat back pocket. You'll find a connection card looks something like this. We'd love you to take that and fill it out. You can drop it in the offering plate when it comes around. We're just so glad that you're here. And then inside your bulletin, if you had a chance to get one of these today, the same thing is right there. You can take that and fill it out, one of these, and drop it in the offering plate. At the end of the service, we're on the door right here in the main lobby. We have a special gift for you just for coming to our church. And we're so always thankful to have guests with us here at Franklin Road Baptist. Well, it's a special day. We have a lot of guests today, and this is offering time. I'm going to ask one of our men to come and pray for the offering right now. Praying for us for the offering is Colonel Andy Easterly with United States Army retired. He's a member of our church. Let me just say for the offering today, as we pray for America and pray for our offering, if you're a guest today, do not feel obligated to give. This will be for our home folk, but we'll do this right to begin the service and move this out of the way. We're glad you're here. Brother Easterly, why don't you come and pray for us today and pray for our great nation and the offering. God bless you.
Pastor. Please join me in prayer. Father, we come to you and we humbly thank you, Father, for this day. We thank you for this land that we call America. We thank you for the liberty that we have, for the sovereignty of this nation, Father. We thank you for the freedom to worship, to express our faith. Thank you for the guest speaker, for all the guests present, Father. We pray your blessing upon each and every person here today. We ask you to use the music, the preaching, the speaking, just the atmosphere, Father, mostly your word to touch our hearts in a special way. And mostly we ask that if there be anyone here with us today that does not know Christ as their Savior, that this will be the day of salvation and not only freedom, but, Father, eternal freedom someday. We ask your blessing upon this offering, Father. We pray that every bit of it be used to further your kingdom and for your glory, Father, on this earth. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.
In just a moment, the choir will sing a medley of theme songs for each of the four main branches of the military. When your fight song begins, please make your way up to the platform with your fellow soldiers so that we may thank and honor you today.
Amen. I'll ask them to just remain standing for just a moment, and let me remind all of us today, only two defining forces have ever offered to die for you. One was the Lord Jesus Christ, and the other the American soldier. One died for your freedom, one died for your soul. And I'm so grateful for these standing behind me and others that could not be with us, and it reminds us once again how great America is. And we do have a breed of soldiers here behind me that are quickly moving off the scene. That is those from World War II. And I'm going to ask us to do just a couple of things here in just a moment. As these step off the platform in just a while, I like for those that are World War II, actually you served in the war there. We'll ask you just to remain here for just a moment. And one more time, let's give these a thank you as they return their seats. God bless you.
Returning to their seats, would you take your songbooks, hymn number 429, Onward Christian Soldiers Marching Us to War. These fought for our freedom here on this earth, but as Christian soldiers, we're to fight for our Lord Jesus Christ. And let's sing together just a verse here of Onward Christian Soldiers, and then we will honor our World War II veterans. Let's sing it together.
Onward Christian Soldiers,
singing, you may be seated.
We've never done this. We felt led to do it this year. World War II, when I first became pastor 20 years ago, the largest group that came in our Patriotic Sunday were the World War II guys. Now it's pretty much the Vietnam era guys. And all soldiers are honorable. We're so thankful for all of them. But here are four today. This is Brother Shoemate right here, Brother Frost, Brother Bushow, and Brother Hamilton. I just asked them, I want to do something here. I just asked them, how old were they when they enlisted? I'm going to give you that number in just a moment. Let me just say this. 16 million soldiers, 16 million enlisted during the World War II era. Think of that number, 16 million. Only 3% are still living. And these are here. Also, Dr. Al Byers, a member of our church that could not come up. These are the ones that we are aware of that's in our presence today that fought in World War II. I asked them what their age were. I think, Brother Shoemate, you served in the Air Force, am I correct? World War II. And
Army Air Corps.
And he was a pilot. And by the way, one of the guys that's flown Mach what? Mach 2. Some of you younger folks, you say, how fast is that? Just think of Woody on that movie. He enlisted, he was 17 years old. Brother Frost, U.S. Army?
17, no, Navy.
Navy? Navy? 17 years old, is doing mission work now. Brother Bushow, you were 18,
yes.
U.S. Army. And then also Brother Hamilton, you were 17?
18
when you enlisted. Let's do this right here, just kind of get a fix on this. These are the people, and this is the ones that stormed the beaches. We heard all the stories about them, World War II. If you are 17 or 18 years old, you stand right now, please. If you're in here, and some of them are in other services. If you're 17 or 18, stand right now. 17 or 18 years old, go ahead, stand up. 17, 18, that era. This is the age of the folks that actually saved our nation and saved the world during that time. And thank you. You may be seated. While we honor all of our military today, and what a wonderful thing is, with tears in my eyes every time they come to the stage, just like they did a moment ago, every year, Vietnam, Iraq, the Korean War, all of that, we're grateful for these that are still, I'm not going to ask them their age, but if I'm a guess a man, I think they're all in their 90s. I know I've celebrated some of their birthdays. Let's give them one more hand. God bless you. Thank you, men, for serving our nation. God bless you.
Thank you for participating in honoring our soldiers. You may be seated.
This is the land of the free.
there are those with us whose loved ones were pictured up there, and there are a few ladies who are widows of some of those that fought for our freedom. At this time, we'd ask, if you're in the building, we don't know exactly who was able to make it, who wasn't, but if you would stand, if your loved one was up there and you are a widow of that soldier, would you stand so that we can give you a rose? We've got several of them here, and these gentlemen, these Marines, would like to hand you a rose, and I will not name all of them because I will miss one or two, and I don't want to offend in any way. But let's give these ladies a hand for their support for their loved one. Last song that the choir sang, I'm sure if you were listening to the words or focusing on them at all, you noticed that the first verse was about the soldier himself away from home and looking back. And of course, we have freedom because of their bravery and their sacrifice. But then the second verse focused on the one at home here, looking toward them and wishing that they would come home or could have come home. And let's just remember that there are still those right now who are in active duty, and they have loved ones who are on American soil right now, who are wishing that they would come home safely. So let's continue to pray for our military and for those that love them as well, who are holding the ropes here at home. Would you take your songbooks? Hymn number 55, Alas and Did My Savior Bleed. We've already mentioned this morning that our soldiers, many of them had to die for our freedom. But remember that our Savior died for our sins to give us a home in heaven. Let's sing about him. Would you stand with me? Alas and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die?
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred death for such a worm as I? At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
That second verse, was it for crimes?
Was it for crimes that I have done?
Let's sing that last verse, but drops of grief.
But drops of grief can never repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do. At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Oh, it's beautiful singing. You may be seated.
Thank you.
fought in World War II. He proudly waves, oh glory, from high upon his roof. He starts out every morning like it's Independence Day. I've seen him at attention salute the flag and say, I love this land from sea to shining sea. I love this land, home of the brave and free. I love the liberty, the justice, and the truth in which we stand. One nation under God. I love this land. All across the country, in big cities, little towns, while mama's getting ready, dad pulls the car around. They join the congregation to sing Amazing Grace. They're free to worship Jesus, and they are free to pray. I love this land, from sea to shining sea. I love this land, home of the brave and free. I love the liberty, the justice, and the truth in which we stand. One nation under God. I love this land.
God bless America.
America land. Defend her with my life, for my children, for freedom. I love this land, from sea to shining sea. I love this land, home of the brave and free. I love the liberty, the justice, and the truth in which we stand. One nation under God. I love this land. I love this land. I love this land. One nation under God.
I love this land.
Oh.
I love this land.
I love this land.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies. We sang the first verse earlier and the last verse, but I'd like you to sing the third verse with me. If you would like, the songbook is hymn number 127. We'll have it up on the screens for you as well. But I'd like you to think about the words as we sing it, as we've honored our heroes and our veterans today. Would you stand with me? Oh, beautiful for heroes proved in liberating strife.
Oh, beautiful for heroes.
Think about these words now.
Who more than self their country love and mercy, Lord, and life. America, America, may God thy gold refine till all success.
Thank you for your singing. You may be seated.
We've spent time today honoring our veterans, our soldiers, and our great country. But let's take a moment to reflect on our heritage and where we are now as a nation. We were founded on the principles of the Word of God by godly men who had sought God's wisdom and direction for this great land. But we would be dishonest with ourselves if we were to pretend that America is still a nation that is united in being righteous. There are people who love God and serve Him, but sin and wickedness have become commonplace, accepted in the eyes of much of the general public. Our national sins have brought a reproach on us. Remember, the book of Proverbs says, "Righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people." Claiming that our national motto is "In God we trust" does not make us righteous. Having a church on every corner does not make us righteous. Having Bibles for sale in bookstores does not make us righteous. Athletes in post-game interviews or politicians in political addresses using the name of God doesn't invoke some kind of magical aura of righteousness. No. True righteousness begins in the hearts and lives of individual people. The people in this place, the church of the living God. As we experience God at work in our lives, and as we dedicate ourselves each day to living our personal lives pleasing to Him, then we will see a turning. A turning of our nation to God. Call it a revival. Call it an awakening. Whatever you call it, it will happen when individual Christians begin to live like Christians should. And the change that takes place in our lives will begin to affect those around us. Those that don't know Christ will be drawn to a point of decision to accept or reject Christ. And the more people who accept Christ, the more righteousness will be seen in our nation. If we are honest, we will have to admit that America, just like the Church of Ephesus in the book of Revelation, has lost its first love. But there is good news. We can always come home. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Repent of your sin. Turn back to God. See Him do a mighty work of change in our nation. Would you commit personally to coming home to God?
Somewhere they could call their own to worship God and freedom was their passion. A love so strong it drove them from their home. America was all that they had hoped for. A land of fertile fields and spacious skies. As wind can turn an ember into fire, freedom is the flame that never dies. Through the years our liberty was threatened, and men have died defending freedom's right. But day by day our enemy is changing. Our freedom is the foe that we must fight. Unrestrained we kill the unborn babies. Demanding rights, we justify our sin. God's mercy alone holds his judgment. America, America,
choir. What a spectacular day it has been already, and a day full of honor. And we're always happy to have special guests with us each year, and again we're honored to have Brother Gary Beikirch back with us. And he was a member of the Green Beret Special Forces fighting in Vietnam in the early 70s. In fact, I think it was April 1st, 1970 that the little village that he was set aside to protect, he and I think 12 other Americans they're actually doing some training there as well, was attacked, and heavy firefight ensued. And he was a medic, I believe was one of his duties there, and I will not go into the whole thing in detail. If you were here last year, you had a chance to hear his testimony in particular. I would tell you that as you leave today, he has a special brochure made up about that particular battle and some of the things that he experienced there, but even more so in this, one of the best things that happened to him is he came to Christ when he came home, and he met a lovely lady that got him there. Last year we had Brother Gary Beikirch with us, and he is a Medal of Honor recipient. There's only a handful of those alive in America, and we have one of them here today. And before I have him up, I just want to mention this to all your moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas, that you need to know what the Medal of Honor is, and you need to know what it represents, and you need to be able to recognize it when you see it. Every now and then when I'm in the airport, I'll see somebody wearing a Medal of Honor. He'll have his on today. And you need to tell your little boys and little girls all about it, what that represents. It is hard to tell the story of battle, and most are not able to do that. Brother Beikirch, I want you to know that we're honored that you do tell the story. We are the beneficiaries of what you have to say today. It means so much to us. We had him last year and again this year, but today he's joined by his lovely wife. And I'm going to ask Brother Gary, why don't you come out here and introduce your wife, and let's give a good special welcome to Brother Gary Beikirch. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Trying to get her to come up here, and she's going, no. I'll do probably a better introduction for her as I share some of my story, because she is definitely a very important part of who I am today and why I'm able to be here. But I want to thank you for inviting me to be a part of a special day that we are here to celebrate the freedoms that we enjoy, and as one of the songs that we heard this morning, to have the ability to dream our dreams. I was thinking about that, and how so many people in so many other parts of the world dream a dream, but their dream is to come here, to be able to be here, so that those dreams can be fulfilled. It reminded me just how blessed I am, we are, to be able to be here and to give thanks, to be able to celebrate the freedoms and the blessing we have of being here in this country, and also to remember and honor the men and women who made this day and every day possible. You know, through the years, Molly and I have been blessed, because of my military experience, to travel to a lot of different places and speak it on a variety of topics dealing with my military service. And then there are those other times where once people find out that I worked as a middle school counselor for 33 years, they'll invite me to come and speak about education. Come and ask me, what did I learn in those 33 years about trying to deal with middle school kids, those crazy, crazy middle school kids? And usually they're always concerned and surprised about how does a Green Beret end up working with middle schoolers, you know? And I have to tell them that, well, after getting out of the military, I thought, hey, Green Beret, combat training, what can I do with my life now? I said, I know, I'll go work with seventh graders. Yeah. You know, I figured Vietnam was good training for working with middle schoolers every day. If you really want to know what I mean by that, try to spend a week in a seventh grade classroom. You'll find out. But no matter where we've had that opportunity to be, to speak, whether it's in a church, military events, or in schools, one of the blessings about being there is that it provides us the opportunity to say thank you. And As a Vietnam vet, over the years, I have learned the value of hearing a thank you. Whether you're a military person, a teacher in a classroom, law enforcement officer, or a parent, there's going to come a time when you're doing what you're doing where you're going to wonder, does anybody know what I'm doing? Does anybody know what it's like to be doing this? Does it matter? Because life is going to challenge you at those moments. Life is going to present tests to you. A friend of mine calls those body slams, you know, where life will just pick you up and body slam you down. And it causes you to wonder, why? How did this happen? This wasn't what I was expecting. And what I'm doing, does it really matter? Am I making a difference? Life has a way of doing that, causing you to question and wonder. Is it worth it? Does it matter to anybody? For me, like many, war was that body slam. War is what picked me up and slammed me down. War challenged what I believed. War was an experience for me where I was challenged regarding things that I valued in life. So I'm grateful to be able to be here today so that I can say thank you, because I know that life brings body slams with it. To say thank you to those who served, to say thank you to those who are in law enforcement, to say thank you to those who are teachers, to say thank you to those who are parents when things happen with your children and you wonder why, the disappointments that happen in life. Thank you, because I have learned the importance of what that means. I have learned the importance of the encouragement that that can provide, the comfort that knowing somebody else understands and realizes what it's like to be where I am, to be doing what I'm doing. And especially today, thank you to those veterans for all you've done, and to you as a church for hosting a day like today. Take my word for it, it does make a difference. What you have done already today has made a difference. And on this day, I thought that as we were traveling out here, I was thinking, what would be a good thing to talk about? And I thought about this day and what it represents. And I thought about patriotism. I thought about that word. And then I thought, maybe what I could do is share with you how that word, which at first was just a concept, some abstract, how that word became a reality to me and has become a critical part of who I am today. That word, patriotism. I was thinking about that as the young people were standing here singing in front of us. My introduction to patriotism was probably much like you had. Parades in the town, marching bands, standing on the sidelines, clapping with the marching songs, maybe even just stamping your feet in step. Or maybe marching in the parade as a Cub Scout or a Boy Scout. Growing up, I liked those celebrations, and I enjoyed them. But I don't know if I could have put into words what it was really all about. I didn't really understand what it meant. I had had relatives that served in World War II in Korea, but they never talked about it. The only thing that I got from them was that it was something that I was expected to do. It was my duty. But as little as I knew about patriotism, I like to think that when I decided to join, there might have been a little bit of that in me, thinking about patriotism, not really knowing what it meant yet. But I went ahead and joined. And then 2 years later, I was tested. That patriotic feeling, those patriotic reasons were tested. Not only that, but every reason why I joined was testing. I endured another body slam, this war tested everything that I believed in, everything that I valued. But you see, that's what war does. War challenges us. It challenges who we are. It challenges what we believe. Not only believe, but believe about ourselves. It challenges what we value. War challenges why we do what we do. Because you find yourself having to do some things that are difficult. But war also challenges our feelings, our emotions. It challenges how we feel about ourselves. It challenges how we feel about other people. It challenges how we relate with other people. Like many, I came back from Vietnam different and changed. I came back not valuing things that I used to value before. I came back with feelings that I didn't know how to control. And like many, I looked for something, someone, who might want to just listen. Someone who was there to maybe support. Someone to try to help me understand what it was that I went through. Not that they could understand, but they didn't need to understand. All they needed to do was to just listen and let me talk. Let me try to find out for myself a meaning for everything that happens in war. Unfortunately, this was a different country back then. And not many of us that came home from that war found that kind of reception. Not many of us had that ability to have someone who had a listening ear, but more importantly, a heart that cared. Because I couldn't find that, I decided that I need to find something on my own. And so what I did was I sought what I felt was the safety and the security of a cave up in northern New Hampshire. I left Rochester, New York, my hometown, and I moved into the White Mountains of New Hampshire. I found a nice little cave, and I began to stay there for 2 years, trying to sort out what war had done to me. I sought that safety and that security because I wanted to try to heal the hurt that I was feeling. I wanted to try to find a way to be able to restore value to my life. I wanted to find a way to be able to allow others back into my life again, to find some way of breaking down the walls that I had built for safety. I wanted to find a place for others in my life. Now I'm going to stop for a minute and talk about a cave, because many people, when I mention that, they kind of go, whoa, no. But you know, it's this funny thing. Over the years, I've noticed that many of us find caves to go to. When we hurt, when something happens that we don't understand, many of us find a cave to go to. It may not be a literal cave with stone walls. It may be a cave of just separating yourself from those who care about you. And if that doesn't work, you find ways to make that separation stronger. Alcohol, drugs, become a part of your attempt to keep yourself separate. Because your only goal in being in that cave is because you want to change the way you feel. You want to feel better, you want to feel different. Alcohol and drugs, separation. We do what we can when we hurt. But unfortunately, often our attempts to heal our own hurt result at the expense of relationships, at the expense of our family, at the expense of our marriage, and all too often, it costs us our own life. We enter a cave to change the way we feel. We enter a cave praying that if I can just forget, that'll be getting better. If I can forget, I'll be better. I mention that cave because it was an important part of my life. It was an important part of who I am. I learned a lot in that cave during those 2 years. But also, it was while I was in the cave that I learned that I was being awarded the Medal of Honor. Imagine that. Here I am, hiding in the woods of northern New Hampshire in the White Mountains, living in a cave, and I find out now that they're going to give me a Medal of Honor for something that I'm trying to forget. You see, I enjoyed being in that cave before. I was starting to learn how to accept myself a little bit. I was starting to enjoy the long walks, sitting by waterfalls, sitting alone and just reading, playing my guitar and relaxing. I felt safe again. And now they're going to give me a medal. All the hurt, all the anger, all the guilt came back again. My life was thrown into chaos once more. But you see, something happened in that cave because of something that I brought with me. Not only did I bring my guitar and all my winter gear and backpacking tent and everything, but I also brought a Bible with me. Because I remember reading about a man named David who had also spent some time in a cave. And I thought, maybe you got something you can teach me. So after I found out I was being awarded the Medal of Honor, I opened that Bible and I started reading. And of course, I went to the Psalms. And I found a wonderful Psalm, 49, which talks about life. It talks about the things that we value in life, things that we think are important. But it also had a verse at the last end of the Psalm, verse 20. It says that man that is in honor and understands not is like a beast that perishes. Man that's in honor but doesn't understand honor is like a beast that perishes. When I read that, I said, okay, God, you're giving me a Medal of Honor. I guess maybe I need to understand what honor really is. What does this mean, Lord? And so my purpose, my focus of being in that cave then became not to forget, but to try to understand. Try to understand what honor meant. Try to understand what this Medal of Honor meant. I also remembered something else that I had read in Vietnam. It was a quote that we had in our team house. A quote that really meant something to me. And I had forgotten about it till that point. Because here I was in a cave trying to make sense out of everything that happened to me. And I remembered this quote, that to really live, you must almost die. To those that fight for it, life will have a meaning the protected will never know. To really live, that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to really live. I wanted to have others in my life again. I didn't plan on spending the rest of my life in that cave. I wanted to really live. And then it said, so if you really want to live, you must almost die. If you really want to live, fight for it, Gary. Because if you fight for it, life will have a meaning that those who choose not to fight, that those who just choose to remain safe in life, they'll never know that meaning. So I began my effort to try to really live. I began my effort of fighting again, to try to understand what war had done to me, to try to understand what war meant. And I fought the battles again. I didn't fight them in the jungles of Vietnam, but I fought those battles in my own heart and in my mind. And God was there to help me. To try to understand what it meant to really live. To try to understand what it meant that he said you must almost die if you want to live. I also tried to understand what this Medal of Honor meant. Something began to happen, and I felt that there was a message being formed in my heart and in my mind. I used to share some of my story when I was teaching my students, and one time a seventh grader asked me, they used to ask me some really crazy questions, but once this seventh grader asked me, he said, hey, Mr. B, you said you really loved living in a cave. Why'd you come out of the cave? And I jokingly say, well, There was a small little town near my cave called Lancaster, New Hampshire. And I used to go in because I had a post office box there. And once I went in there, and there was a piece of notebook paper folded up. I opened it up and it said, "Hi, my name's Lolly. I've seen you around town. Lancaster is a very small little town, only one main street, no traffic lights. But," she said, "I've seen you around town." And I kind of stuck out. I had hair down to here. I drove a red van. And so she just started sending me these notes. Then one day I went down there and I found her picture. She always says, "Well, this was before online dating, so this was kind of like mailbox dating." Yeah. So she put her picture in the mailbox. And I thought, aside from the fact of, wow, this is a pretty forward girl, I thought, wow, she's pretty cute. And then one day I started looking for her, now that I knew that she was cute, and I saw her in a laundromat. So I went into the laundromat, started talking with her, asked her out on a date. We went on a date. A couple weeks later, I said to her, "So when are we going to get married?" And she said, "Well, I'll marry you, but you got to come out of the cave." So what brought me out of the cave? Lolly's love. She says that over the years, she's gone into many caves with me, but these were emotional caves. Caves that were part of my heart. Caves that were part of my life. Caves that were just as strong as the walls of those that granite boulders in that cave. But I came out of that cave because of her love. And I found out that getting better, which is why I went into that cave, getting better doesn't happen because you forget. Getting better happens because you find someone who will love you. You find someone who is willing to come into that cave with you. And even though they can't understand what you're going through, it doesn't matter because their love is all you need. Because you sense their care. Because you sense their faithfulness. Because you sense the fact that they will never leave you nor forsake you, no matter what. Finding someone to love will cause you to be able to open up those closed doors to your life and search through the layers of that guilt and that anger and that hurt that you felt built up all those years. Because underneath that, there are some good things that are there. And I was able to find some good things about Vietnam once I worked through the anger and the guilt. I was able to discover the love that we shared with the men that I served with. I discovered the camaraderie that we had, the joy of being with someone, the joy of feeling being with them and their presence giving you a sense of peace. That just being with them enabled you to go through some terrible, terrible times because you knew that they were there with you. They had your back. Lolly helped me to be able to discover those things. I learned that forgetting is not getting better. Getting better is finding someone who loves you. I also came out of that cave because I felt that there was a message that God was forming in my heart. And one day he said, "Gary, it's time to come out of the cave." I said, "Are you sure, God? It's kind of early, isn't it? You know, we're having fun in here. I'm getting to know you. You're getting to know me real better. You know, it's good." He goes, "Do you love me?" "Yes, I love you, Lord." "Then come out of the cave, Gary. I got a message I want you to share." So I came out of that cave to share a message. To share a message about honor. To share a message about the Medal of Honor. To share a message about what it means to really live. To share a message about fighting so that life will have a meaning that those who quit will never know. I'd like to share some of that message with you right now about the Medal of Honor. It's because one of the things that God taught me right away is he said, Gary, this medal is not about you. Most recipients that I know would be the first thing they say is that this is not about me. It's about someone else. It's about those who I fought with, those who protected me, those who gave their life for me. I learned that this is not about me. I learned that this medal is not about one person, any one person, no matter how heroic, no matter how brave their acts were. It's not about one person who did one thing on one day. The honor that comes with this medal is the fact, is the honor that comes because it's greater than one person. It's greater than one person who did one act on one day, because this medal represents countless men and women who every day, even today, serve. Even today, risk their life. Even today, are doing countless acts of service all across, all around this world. Why? Because they love us. Because they love this country. Because they love the freedoms that we have in this country. Because they love the values that guided and directed the men and women who founded this country so that we could have these freedoms. That's what this medal represents. It's bigger than one person, one doing one thing. It represents countless millions of men and women who, since this country was formed, have been willing to sacrifice and serve others. I've come to understand also that this medal symbolizes a message that there's a different way to live your life. There is a different way to live your life, rather than just thinking, what can I get for me? There's a different way to live your life. To really live, you must almost die. You want to really live life? Then try denying yourself and living for someone else. To really live, to experience all that life has to give, try loving someone else more than yourself. I have a friend that trains the Navy SEALs, and he said, you know what I try to instill in Navy SEALs? I try to instill in them the belief, the value of, what can I do to make you look better? Could you imagine being a member of a team that has that as their focus? I'm not interested in getting any notoriety or recognition for me, but what can I do to make you look better? To really live, you must almost die. To really live, I've learned that that means living your life for something beyond yourself. Believing that there is something greater in this life worth living for. Believing that there's something in this life worth fighting for, regardless of the cost. I've come to learn that finding something greater in this life than self has made my life worthwhile, has achieved for me a level of significance that means more to me than anything I could have done that would have been success for me. Significance comes when we make a difference in someone else's life. That's significance. This past week, I was down in Washington for the awarding of another Medal of Honor ceremony to David Bellavia. There are now 71 living Medal of Honor recipients, 71 that are alive. And I thought about something as I watched President Trump put that medal around his neck. I wondered what thoughts were going through his mind, what was going through his heart. You see, because for me, I have learned over the years that when I put this medal around my neck, that there's no room for self. I don't wear this for anything that I've done. I wear it for the men that I served with. I wear it for the men that I fought with. I wear it for those men that didn't come home. I wear it for those families who have an empty place at their table now, an empty heart. But they wear a gold star to recognize that and to honor that memory. I think about those who just graduated from basic training and they can't wait to come home to show their family what they look like in a uniform. I wear it for those people. I wear it for every man and woman who's ever raised their hand and said, I will go anywhere, at any time, at any cost, because I love this country. That's who I wear this medal for. That's what this medal means. I wear it for every first responder, law enforcement. I wear it for those who serve in any organization that serves others. I wear it for every person who believes that to truly live, you must almost die. That's who I wear this medal for. I've come to understand that this Medal of Honor not only has a message, but it's a symbol too. And we have many symbols in this country: the American flag, the White House, the Capitol building, the Washington Monument, those things that you can look at and say, yeah, that's who we are. That's who America is. It's represented in that. I've learned that that's what this medal represents. I've learned that this Medal of Honor represents what lives in the heart and the soul and the mind of every person who loves this country. I've learned that this medal represents why I can't finish the national anthem. I choke up. I learned that this Medal of Honor represents why I cry when I hear taps being played or the bagpipes playing Amazing Grace. The Medal of Honor represents that, because that's what lives in my heart, what lives in my spirit. It's what has become a part of me. It's who I am. I believe that this Medal of Honor represents everything we are as a nation. It symbolizes who we are. It symbolizes the legacy that has been created by countless men and women who have loved this country more than themselves. Thinking about that this morning, I was thinking, maybe that's what my grandfather and my uncles meant when they said, I serve because it's expected. Maybe that's what they meant and were trying to say when they just said, oh, it's my duty. Some call it duty. I call that patriotism. That's what patriotism is. I read once that patriotism flows from the heart of a soldier. I've kind of tried to open up my heart and let flow whatever comes. Perhaps it's patriotism, but it's from my heart. But more importantly than patriotism, what comes out of my heart today is something else that I've learned about this Medal of Honor and what it really means. You see, I learned very early that this Medal of Honor is definitely not about anything that I have done. I don't wear it for my honor. I wear it for God. I wear it for His honor. I wear it for what He has done. You see, because I would not have survived Vietnam without His grace. I should have died in Vietnam. I wouldn't have survived Vietnam without His grace. It's only because of His love and His forgiveness that I've been able to survive what war did to me. It's only because of His strength and His faithfulness that I've been able to come out of the cave and face the body slams of life, because God has been faithful to me. When I wear the Medal of Honor, I wear it for Him. I wear it for His honor. And for over 40 years, He's not only been my God, but He's been my Savior. There have been times when I wanted to go back into the cave because I couldn't see where I was going next. At those times, He was my guide. There have been times when I wanted to go back in the cave because I just said, I got to give up. I don't have the strength to go on. There's no use. During those times, He's been my hope. There have been times when I felt there was nobody that could understand me. Nobody. Anything that I did didn't matter to anybody because I was just alone. It was at those times that He said, Gary, I'm your friend. Take my hand. We'll get through this, Gary. When I wear this, I wear it for Him, for His honor, because He is the one that's given my life a purpose. He's given my life a reason. And He's given me a message. He's given me a message of greater love. I want to thank you for inviting me, giving me the opportunity to share just a small portion of the message that I learned during those 2 years in the cave. But it was that message that brought me out of the cave. It was a message of believing. A message of believing that there's something more important in life than self. That there's something greater. It's a message of living. Living your life, loving another more than self. It's a message of a love that's greater than any of the pain or the hurt or the guilt that war can cause. It's a message of a greater love, the love of God, which can bring us out of our caves. It's a message of a greater love that Jesus spoke about when he said, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." Jesus laid his life down for us. Jesus said that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him, Gary, should not perish, but have everlasting life. That is the message that brought me out of the cave, a message of greater love. And it's my prayer today that if you've ever felt like going into a cave, or if you find yourself in a cave, it's my prayer that you will realize that there's a greater love, the love of a God who will come into that cave with you, heal your hurts, give you the peace and the comfort you're looking for, and walk with you as you leave that cave, and walk with you into a life that's truly worth living. In closing, I'm often asked, why is it that men and women join? Why is it that men and women are so willing to serve, to go to foreign places, to leave their families, to make such a great sacrifice? Why is it? And I came across a quote that I think really expresses what lives in the heart and the soul and the spirit of every man and woman who serves. And the quote is, "The true soldier fights not because he hates what's in front of him." We so often think about war and hate. But this quote says that the true soldier fights not because he hates what's in front of him. The true soldier fights because he loves what is behind him. The true soldier fights because he loves what is behind him and is loved by who is behind him. On this patriotic day, I want to thank you in this community, in this church. Those of you who have stood behind and stood alongside all those who through the years have served and sacrificed for us. Thank you for being there. Thank you for listening to them. Thank you for supporting them and caring for them. Thank you for your love for them. And for those of you who have served, and your families, I want to thank you for your service and your sacrifice. It's your love for something greater than self that has kept us free. It's your actions and your acts of service and sacrifice that have defined who we are, defined who we are as a people, defined who we are as a nation. It's your love, your sacrifice, and your service that has defined who we are as Americans. And I'm honored to be counted as one of you. Thank you, and may God bless you, this country, and all those who serve.
Stand. Let's bow our heads for just a moment. We have just a little more service that we want to do here. With our heads bowed, our eyes closed, I want to ask you just a couple of things. We're going to play something softly here on the piano, but all of us are happy to be Americans today, and I know that we'd agree with what Brother Beikirch said about love, and one of the most wonderful things is that day that he read that first little letter from Lolly, and he met her, and she was a born-again Christian. And you get a chance to read the rest of his story. I want to challenge you to pick these up. But she was the one that God used to actually get him to the Lord. And he had his Bible there, and he was doing all the right things. And I'm so thankful that God put Lolly in the life of Gary Beikirch. They're married now. They have a family. They serve the Lord together and doing things just like this all across America. And I'm grateful that he came here to tell us just a portion of his testimony. Let me just ask this question today right now. How many of you say, I'm a born-again Christian, I know I'm saved. Would you put your hand up real high? I know I'm saved. Got that all settled, pinned down. Thank you. Put your hands down. I don't want you to miss this part of the service, and that is this. If you could not raise your hand right there, you're not sure that you're a born-again Christian, we would love for you to leave this building that way, saved. The Bible teaches us, he read to you, quoted John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And today we only give you the chance to do that. The Bible teaches that if you believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, if you'll believe that he was buried for 3 days, if you'll believe he rose again, literally Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died for you and rose again that third day, you'll believe he is alive right now. You can trust Christ and become a born-again Christian right now, asking God to forgive you of your sins. The Bible teaches there's none righteous, no, not one. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. I want to give you a chance to receive that free gift today. And pray with me this sinner's prayer if you've never done that. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'd like to give you a chance to do that right now. If you'll believe that Christ died for you on the cross, that he was buried, he rose again the third day, that thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, that's praying, and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Here's that prayer right now. Father, I realize I'm a sinner, and I believe you died for me on the cross. I believe you rose again on the third day. And I believe you're alive right now. Lord, I ask you to forgive me of my sins, come into my heart, and make me a Christian. In Jesus' name I pray. Our heads are bowed. No one's looking right now. I want who to say this, preacher, I prayed that prayer. I meant that. I want to be a born-again Christian. Would you put your hand up real high where I can see it? I prayed that. I meant that. I want to be a born-again Christian. God bless you, sir. Thank you. On my right, on my left, God bless you. Just put your hand right up, right back down. I prayed that. I meant that. What a wonderful day it's been. Let's leave today with the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you. I'm going to have you be seated right now. I'm going to ask you to do one more thing. And that is this. Many of you lift your hands just a moment ago and you said you were a born-again Christian. Some of you just prayed that prayer and you said, I want to be a Christian. I want to be saved. Could I ask you to do this? Could I ask you to pray for America? I want who would say this. I want to make it my point every day to pray for our nation. And before you lift your hand, let me just say this. America's in a tough place right now. We're divided in many ways. But what we need is really what was talked about a moment ago in one of the choir songs. We need a revival. We need an awakening. Wouldn't it be a terrible thing for America to be healthy economically and in poor condition spiritually and morally? Today, I want to get you to make a commitment to pray for America. Would you do that? How many say, I'm going to begin praying for America every day? Would you put your hand up real high? I'm going to begin praying. Make a point to find yourself somewhere in your prayer closet, maybe at noon, maybe in the evening. But let's pray for America. Father, we do thank you for today. We thank you for the wonderful message, Lord. And Lord, how love can get us out of the cave. And Father, there are people here today. There are people here today, maybe in some form of a cave, as Brother Beikirch mentioned. They're hiding, they're running, they're trying to figure out life and trying to figure out a better way to live. Lord, may they come to you today. Teach us that, we pray, please, in Jesus' name. Amen. With their heads bowed, we'll sing one verse of song today. Let's say God speak to our hearts. Would you do that?
Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. See on the portals he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home.
All right, thank you for looking this way. Appreciate you so much being here today. We have special guests with us. We've already met many of our military and veterans, and we're so thankful and grateful for all of them. It's been a spectacular day. I've enjoyed the kids singing. But also we invited a lot of our dignitaries here, county and state, and some of them are able to come and be with us today. We want you to meet these. These are folks that lead us here in our great city and county and state. We're so thankful for them, and some of them come just about every year, and some are new this year. I want you to join me in welcoming our county mayor, Mill Ketron, his wife, Teresa. Good to have you all stand right here. God bless you all. Thank you for coming today. So good to have them with us today. Also, our city vice mayor, Madeline Scales Harris. Could you stand us all here? God bless you. Thank you for your leadership. I so enjoy doing this because these are the people that actually work with us here in our county, and they do such a fantastic job. We don't do this every year, but when they get a chance to come, they have their own churches they can go to, but they came to ours today. And also good to have State Senator Don White and her husband, Chad. Could I have them stand here? God bless you all. Also, State Representative, 49th District, Mike Sparks. Where's Mike at? God bless you, Brother Mike. Good to see you there. State Representative, 34th District, Tim Rudd, makes his home right here. God bless you, Tim. Got him on the front row today. God bless you. Amen. Also, Juvenile Court Judge Donna Davenport. Where you at, Judge? God bless you. Our city councilman, Ronnie Martin, his wife, Cynthia, are here. Could you have you all stand? God bless you all. Thank you for being here. Good. City councilman, Eddie Smotherman, his wife, Brenda, are here. God bless you all. Good to see you. Commissioner Steve Irvin, his wife, Debbie, are here. Can I have you all stand? God bless you all right here. Amen. Our county commissioner, District 13, Paul Johnson. Don't believe you've missed a one, except the year you're sick, I think. God bless you, Paul. Good to see you. Our property assessor, Rob Mitchell. Where's Rob at? God bless you, Mr. Mitchell. Thank you for being here. Highway Commissioner Keith Bradshaw. God bless you. Good to see you, Keith. Juvenile Court Judge Donna Scott Davenport. Where's she? Oh, I already got you there. Got you. Double whammy. That's two extra votes right there. God bless you. All right. State Executive Tennessee Republican Party, 14th District, Jim Sandman. Where's he at? God bless you. There he is. Amen. Field Representative for Congressman Scott Desjarlais, Lynn Davis is here. God bless you. Good to see you. Tell our congressman we said hello. I have a chance to be in his office a few times. Good to see you today. Also, Murfreesboro policeman Corey Jessimer is here. God bless you. I probably killed that name. I think I noticed you came up as a Marine today, if I'm not mistaken. Amen. God bless you. Also, we're happy to have Middle Tennessee President of First Bank, Ben Weatherfield, and his wife Margie here. Can I have them stand? God bless you all. Good to see them today. Thank you all for being here. And others, I hope I didn't miss anybody. We're just so glad that you're here today. It's been a wonderful day. Thank you for coming. I want to show you real quick what's coming up next. We'll be dismissed. Okay.
If you are new to our church, we want you to feel at home. Please take a moment to provide us with some information about you via the connection card found in today's bulletin or in the pocket of the seat in front of you. Bring it to the welcome area after service where our pastor and his wife will have a free gift for you. We look forward to connecting with you.
We have special events throughout the year, such as Vacation Bible School and Junior Camp, as well as weekly classes and programs for kids of all ages on Sundays and Wednesdays. God is doing some amazing things in the lives of the kids of our church, and we'd love to have your child be a part of it.
It is almost time for our FRBC kids to attend summer camp at Triple S Christian Ranch. This week of preaching will encourage and challenge your young person to grow in their relationship with Christ while also providing opportunities to have fun with various activities, games, and time with friends. So don't let them miss this exciting opportunity. Our annual Youth Summit begins soon for young people grades 7 through 12. Teens from our church, as well as other churches, will enjoy exciting games and activities and will be challenged by powerful Bible preaching. Visit youth.frbc.com to learn more or register your young person for this year's FRBC Youth Summit. To get involved with any of these opportunities, stop by the information desk in the lobby. You can learn more about our church by seeing today's bulletin or visiting our website. Thanks again for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you again soon, right here at Franklin Road Baptist Church.
All right, let's stand together. We'll be dismissed, and thank you again so much for coming. Some of you might want to meet Brother Beikirch and his wife, Lolly. We're going to have them right down front right here, and if you want to get a chance to meet him. Also, we have a quick refreshment for all of our dignitaries and a little gift right over in this room right here to the right. So as you can leave, you can slip right through this door, and we'd like for you to do that as well. We have something special. Also, Brother Beikirch will be in real quick to see you as well. And we're so glad to have you. So thankful to have all of our veterans and our service personnel here today. It's been a spectacular day. As you leave, we'll sing our Going Home song, but as you leave, we want you right out on the table right out here, the big round table. I think you'll find these brochures. I want you to pick that up. I failed to read the citation, but his citation is in here, and the gallantry and so forth on that day on April the 1st. A lot of that is mentioned here. He told his story some last year. He'll be back tonight in our 6:30 service speaking as well if you'd like to pop back and hear more. Again, thank you so much for coming. Let's sing together.
God bless America, land that I love. Let's sing that chorus together.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with gold.
You have a wonderful afternoon. We'll see you back tonight if you're able.